will get benefited by your vast experience of teaching and learning. In the same line, I am thankful to Ms. Meera Patel as a keynote speaker, who have kindly consented to. She has many cases before the Supreme Court, and I found her as a key keen learner and a dedicated researcher, and an activist. More than that, an activist to women who is fighting for the justice for the women, and has been associated with various forums related to women. So I welcome you, Meera. Let me share with you all that School of Law and Constitutional Studies, a constituent school of Shobhit University, that is known as Shobhit Institute of Technology, deemed to be University Meerut, was started in 2013. And we admit the fact that we are a very young law school. And also we would like to remain young in terms of teaching and learning and all the processes we are having here. So today we have gathered here to discuss with some of the expert of the industry or academia, so that our student can be benefited through the contemporary legal issues, what issues are being there, or what is happening in the field of law. We have started a series of lectures that is known as Gyan Arjan, an expert lecture series. What we are doing in that, we are requesting the eminent personalities from the academia, from the industry, from the legal field, and they are talking up with our student, so that our young future professionals can get the actual idea that what is happening in the field of law and what are the prospectives are there. So for this, the Gyan Arjan series has been started, and we are having a number of lectures before this session. And today we are talking about the, as Neha has mentioned, that we are having this lecture on tackling gender-based violence against women during COVID-19. Apart from this, the school is offering some of the courses like BA-LLB, BB-LLB honors, BCom-LLB honors, LLM, and including PhD also. So apart from this, the school has founded some of the centers which are working as a bridge between the government and the public at large. We are having Center for Law and Good Governance here at campus, which is working as a bridge to fill up the gap that what the law is right now we are having and what the law ought to be. So with this sequence, we are having two experts with us. Shri Pramod Kumar Goyal Saab is not with us. He is traveling and his flight was late, though he may be join us very soon if they are reaching on time. So I over to you, Neha, to proceed with the session, and I'm sure that the student will be benefited by the vast experience of our learned panelists, or rather I should say the expert in the field of law. Over to you, Neha.
Thank you, sir. So without taking much time, I would like to invite our first eminent speaker, Ms. Meera Kaura Patel, advocate on record, Supreme Court of India. Ms. Meera Kaura Patel is highly successful and dedicated attorney practicing in the Supreme Court of India, Delhi High Court and Delhi District Courts. And she is also registered as an advocate on record for the Supreme Court of India. Mrs. Patel's main practice area is family and matrimonial, criminal law, intellectual property right, arbitration, LGBT, gender issues, sexual harassment of women at workplace, and human rights. After completing her graduation in English literature from University of Delhi, Mrs. Patel explored the love for the law, and she completed her LLB from the Faculty of Law, University of Delhi in 2006. She was called to the bar in 2006 as she is enrolled as an advocate with Bar Council of Delhi. Passionate about the law, she pursued higher academic brilliance. She obtained an LLM degree from the Faculty of Law, University of Ottawa, Canada in 2008. Mrs. Patel is on a panel as a counsel for central government litigation at Supreme Court of India. She also worked as a senior legal counsel at Aga and Company Dubai, United Arab Emirates, and handled various matters pertaining to the corporate commercial arbitration and litigation. Mrs. Patel has also been associated with the Society Against Violence in Education as an honorary legal head for the last decade. She also has authored a book which is useful for instruction of legal research and methodology titled Uniform Legal Citation, published by Universal Law Publication. So, ma'am, over to you.
Thank you, Neha. Thank you very much for the introduction. At the outset, I would first like to thank the School of Law and Constitutional Studies, Shobhit University, for inviting me for this discussion and for organizing this event, this seminar, webinar on such an important and vital issue, which is, which is of very, very relevance in the present moment during COVID pandemic. And I would also like to extend my thanks to Dr. Mohammed Imran, Associate Dean, Shobhit University, School of Law, and also to my co-speakers, Dr. Professor Kiran Rai and Pramod Kumar Goyal. Let me start with the session without much ado. Neha, I'll just like your help. Just let me know if my screen is visible to all.
Yeah, it is visible.
Let me. I'll just bring it to full screen for everybody's convenience.
Yeah, sure,
So tackling gender-based cyber violence is our topic for today. And let me first, this issue is of vital importance in the present times, given that, with the advent of technology, we see that the nature and manner and mode of crime which were taking place against women and children in the physical domain, they have taken a new shape, they have taken a new color. Now, the crimes that were being committed in the physical reality, they have shifted to the virtual reality. The workplaces, the schools, which we had never contemplated as being virtual workplaces, virtual schools, they have become virtual today. And the nature of offenses that, we had imagined or we had heard of, because it took some time for India to get used to work from home. There were sectors already, which were involved in work from home work, like IT sectors, pharmacy sectors, big corporates. They already had work from home arrangements, but we never envisaged places like schools, universities, smaller workplaces, smaller corporates to have this kind of facility. But now today that we are faced with the reality, we are faced with this COVID pandemic, everything has shifted online. And therefore, there is a drastic change in the nature of offenses which are being committed against women and children. The offenses of sexual harassment, which were being committed when women were physically visiting their workplaces, when they were interacting with their colleagues, when they were interacting with their bosses, those offenses are now they are capable of being committed online. I'm not saying that the online offenses were not taking place as much, but all I'm saying is that it has increased because of the present times, because COVID-19 accentuated and expedited the virtual growth and the virtual workplaces. So I just want to share with you the statistical data that is available with NCRB, the National Crime Bureau. They released certain in their reports on crime in India. In 2017, if you see, there were 4,330 cases registered against women and children. In 18, it was 6,262. The last report that was available was a 2019 report where we see 8,684 cases. And I'm sure that this number must have doubled by 2021. Because until 2019, we did not have the same framework that we had in 2020 and 2021. There is also a report by a National Commission for Women. So they have received in the year 2020 about 704 complaints. Now, this is just to inform the viewers that National Commission for Women as such does not receive as many complaints. I mean, the kind of complaints that we see in workplaces, they first get reported to the organization itself, to the employer itself, or to the state agencies like police. And some women do report. So this is only partial reporting that we see here. It cannot give us a complete picture. But still, what was available online, I fetched it for the audience to see. Now, I just want to give you a brief description about what is a cybercrime. Cybercrime as such has not been defined under Information Technology Act, although we hear the term cybercrime time and again, but there is no specified definition as such. However, in simple terms, it can be understood in any unlawful act where a computer or a communication or an electronic device or a computer network is used to commit or facilitate the commission of a crime. Now, some of the examples are, DDoS attacks, which is taking the network down, committing identity thefts, doing social engineering. Then you have confidential data, breach of privacy, stalking, and several other kind of cyber crimes that are committed. Now, if cyber crime is the bigger set, cyber violence against women would only be a subset. So there are financial frauds also. Now, this presentation does not really take into account that aspect. We are not covering the financial aspect of the cyber crimes. But cyber violence, what is cyber violence? Cyber crime convention committee working group on cyberbullying and other forms of online violence, especially against women, children, they have defined cyber violence as the use of computer systems to cause or to facilitate threaten violence against individuals, which is likely to or which results in any kind of physical, sexual, psychological, economic harm or suffering, and which may include individual's exploitation of the individual circumstances. Now, what are the kinds of cyber violence that are committed against women and children? Let me at the outset point out that I'm only giving some of the examples of the kinds. This per se is not exhaustive list, but the kind of harassment that women and children do face. One is a general harassment, which can happen through emails or electronic messages. So a lot of times what happens is that women receive a lot of messages from strangers, from known persons, from colleagues. Now, these could be general messages. Somebody's asking, even asking, how are you? Or you look beautiful, or you look, kind of words being used, are you look sexy, things like that. They're people who don't even know you, and they try and contact you time and again, repeatedly sending these kind of messages that can constitute harassment. And any messages that have the effect of intimidating the woman or causing her annoyance could be taken as general harassment. Sending content like love letters that, I find you pretty, I'm in love with you, or things like that also. If the woman says she doesn't want to talk and a person is repeatedly sending these kind of messages, apart from being just general harassment, that could also be covered under stalking, which we will be discussing in a while. Now, apart from that, there can be sexual harassment through email and electronic messages. Now, sexual harassment harassment would include asking for sexual favors. It could include making sexually colored remarks. It could be sharing any kind of clips of sexually explicit material or pornographic material. Now, these kind of messages being exchanged or sent to the woman through WhatsApp, email, electronic messages, SMS, or even during meetings like these, if somebody just pops up a sexually explicit material, that could constitute to some extent harassment. Now, coming to sexual harassment per se, the legislature has defined sexual harassment at various places. And when we deal with the legislative framework, I'll be coming to the definition of sexual harassment. But at this moment, I just want to point out, if the act of a person fulfills the ingredients as specified in certain sections of the law, for example, 354A of Indian Penal Code, or for that matter, the POSH Act, the Sexual Harassment at the Workplace Act, also defines sexual harassment. Now, the sexual harassment, if it has not taken physically, but has taken place on a virtual domain, and it fulfills the ingredients that are specified under those laws, then that can constitute an offense. Now, cyber stalking is when somebody is monitoring the activity of a woman online, or repeatedly trying to enter the same chat rooms that she's in, posting certain messages, trying to build contact with her, or stalking her, like physically stalking would have been that a person is following you. But virtually it means that her activities are being monitored by a person. Cyber defamation is like cyber smearing. So cyber defamation occurs when somebody is publishing some defamatory content about the woman or the girl. Here I've used the word children because a lot of offenses that are applicable to girls are equally applicable to whether it's a male child or a female child. So any defamatory content about the child or the woman would constitute cyber defamation. Child pornography would mean publishing or making video of a child or having the child engage in a sexually explicit act. Then the next is cyberbullying. Now, cyberbullying per se is a concept which is slightly different from the other sexual offenses that are committed against women and children. Bullying per se cannot be said totally gendered. It is gender neutral as well. However, we do see that because women and children are more vulnerable, they are subject to cyberbullying to a larger extent and much more than what their other gender counterparts are subjected to. Cyberbullying per se is not recognized as an offense otherwise, but if it fulfills the ingredients of any other offenses, bullying may be punishable. For example, bullying is one of the subsets of ragging. So if ragging is a punishable offense, which it is by virtue of a lot of state legislations, if the same acts were committed virtually, then they may be an offense under those laws. So cyberbullying and cyber ragging can be used interchangeably as well. Cyber grooming. Now, cyber grooming is a concept that's usually we see a lot of adolescent girls and young girls. They are being they chat or with some strangers who try and take them into confidence so that they open up, they reveal their personal details. Sometimes what happens is they end up meeting the stranger also, or they end up sending certain intimate photographs to that stranger because he has developed some level of confidence. So that is cyber grooming, where you groom a minor, you kind of take him into confidence, and then later you ask him to perform certain acts, which could be sexual acts. It could also be asking the minor to disrobe himself or herself. And sometimes there is an additional offense that gets committed. That is, after taking the pictures or videos, the person, the accused, goes on to publish that material online or goes on to, threaten the child. That, you know, I will release this online if you don't give me money or if you don't come and you do not have a physical relationship with me. We've had cases of cyber grooming. I've handled some of the cases. Then morphing. Morphing is pretty common. I'm sure everybody would be aware where a picture of a woman, that maybe they're maybe there's a picture of a nude woman and somebody else's face is morphed onto that picture. And it is projected as if that woman is the same as whose face appears in that picture. And it's very common. This kind of thing happens a lot with the celebrities, the Bollywood celebrities. And it is pretty common. Then impersonating and identity theft. Now impersonating is when somebody's, making somebody's fake profile. So for example, somebody makes my fake profile using my name and then they reach out to people, several strangers. So I recently had this case, and day before yesterday, somebody called me, a lady called me, and she said that somebody had created her fake profile and contacted several strangers on the internet, quoting that, you know, she is a prostitute and certain rates and everything was given. And this act was actually to defame her. Somebody who had enmity with her was doing it. So we have contacted CyberCell, we've made complaint, and they are yet to trace the identity. But this is also a very common crime which is being committed. Then breach of privacy, of course. If the credentials or the details of the woman or the child, they get access through a lot of malicious softwares, through spam emails that people end up opening, so their privacy gets violated. Then sextortion is a kind of an extortion, which is sex plus extortion. So for example, I gave an example of cyber grooming. In cyber grooming, the person, builds confidence and then later on starts threatening the person that if you do not have physical relation with me, I'll do this. So sometimes they extort money. They say that, you know, I have your pictures, which they secure by cyber grooming. And then they say, I will publish these pictures or I'll send these pictures to your family if you do not give me money. So that is sextortion. Then doxing is another. Doxing is about searching for private or identifying information about an individual on the internet. And another form is revenge porn. Revenge porn has become pretty common. This is usually done by intimate partners where, you know, persons were in a relationship before and owing to some issues between them, they have broken up. But while they were in relationship, they had certain intimate pictures. Now, the intimate partner, as an act of taking revenge, sometimes publishes this content. And that is called revenge porn. So these are only some of the kinds of gender-based offenses that are being committed against women and children. Now, what are the main causes of gender-based cyber violence? I've made a very brief slide on this issue. One part of this is attributed to the social and patriarchal beliefs and the systems that, you know, we have in place for a long time. Violence against women has been present in our society since times immemorial. And women have long been subjugated, exploited. These are some of the common causes. Apart from that, I feel that, women coming out of the closets, women coming out in the open to work, we have confident young women pretty much in every sphere and every walk of life. Now, what happens is sometimes I feel that women pose a challenge to the masculinity or, the patriarchal beliefs, and sometimes we are challenging the stereotypes, the male stereotypes. A woman who is smart, who's active, who can interact with everyone, sometimes are seen as challenging certain stereotypes, and they also become easy targets for these kind of offenses. At the same time, I do not mean to say that women who are meek or, you know, who are humble or who are homely, they do not suffer cyber attacks. In fact, they may be equally vulnerable as well, because they may not know where to complain, to whom to complain. And especially the girls between the age of 10 to 18, where we do see that parents are not supervising the cyber activity as much, they are more vulnerable to cyber attacks. Then the another issue is the inadequacy in the legal framework. As of now, I mean, we discuss so many kinds of cyber offenses that are committed against women and children. I don't think that the legal framework that we have currently is adequate enough to deal with the nature of offenses that are taking place. In fact, many a time, you know, we see the police struggling with, you know, they get a complaint and they think, okay, what to do now? Under which provision do we go? So, for example, a general harassment. If somebody is posting content about a woman online, on Twitter, for example, and this is just, it's not sexual in nature, but it may be, you know, causing general harassment. Now, we do not have 66A anymore, which dealt with posting offensive messages or posting offensive content. So with the Shreya Singhal's case, 66A being declared unconstitutional, we do see that there is a lacuna now, there is a gap in law now. And for these kind of messages, which are not really sexual in nature, we find it difficult to find a particular legislation under which offenders can be booked. Now, the third reason is obviously the increase in use of technology, because, you know, everything is shifting to virtual. Like I said, with the increase in use in technology, we do see these offenses are going up. So these are some of the main causes for the gender-based cyber violence. Now, what are the legal provisions which are dealing with cyber violence against women? Some of these legal provisions are equally applicable to non-cyber domain, which is to the physical domain. But because these provisions are there and we do not have enough sections in the IT Act covering the cyber offenses, we fall back on the you know, the common legal provisions like Indian Penal Code. Indian Penal Code introduced certain sections in the 2013 amendment. So sexual harassment versus 354A. What is sexual harassment has been defined under 354A. So a man committing any of the following acts, which is unwelcome and explicit sexual overtures, a demand or request for sexual favors, showing pornography against the will of a woman, making sexually colored remarks. Now, these all constitute acts of sexual harassment, and a person, if he is doing this, obviously without the consent of the woman, he would be liable for sexual harassment under Section 354A. And these are cognizable offenses, and the punishments prescribed therein, which it may extend to 3 years or more. Now, 354C, it's a very important provision, because this was the first time we had, you know, the offense of voyeurism included in Indian Penal Code and in Indian law also. Now, what is voyeurism? Voyeurism includes the act of watching or capturing the image of a woman engaging in a private act and or disseminating the said image without her consent. Now, it includes the act of watching or the act of capturing the image of a woman engaging in a private act. Now, what is a private act? The private act has been defined separately in 354C. It says that private act would be where a woman is changing clothes, or a woman is where her posterior, her breast, or her private parts are visible, or she's in her innerwear and that is visible, or that she is using a laboratory. Now these are some of the acts which have been included in the Private Act. Now, I feel that this is a, when we talk about the gaps in the law, I feel this is a very narrow, definition of Private Act which has been given. And voyeurism for now would include these kind of cases only, where, there was a case actually, there was a case where one of the women ministers was using a showroom's changing room, a cloth, she went to buy some clothes, she was using the changing room and there was a camera. So that constitutes, watching her changing clothes where her body may be visible. That may constitute a private act where she has the apprehension of not being watched by anyone. Now, that is one aspect of voyeurism. Now, what happens sometimes is when two persons are in a relationship, a woman may have consented to taking of certain pictures, taking of certain intimate pictures. Now, voyeurism also includes dissemination of such images without her consent. So that is another aspect where the woman may have consented to taking of the pictures, but she may not have consented to dissemination of such pictures. That would be covered under Section 354C, Indian Penal Code. 354D is another important section that was introduced, which includes stalking. Now, stalking as well as cyber stalking. Stalking generally has been defined to mean an act where a man follows or contacts a woman, and despite of her clear indication that she is not interested, he still follows her. That is stalking. Cyber stalking, on the other hand, has been defined as monitoring the cyber activity or use of internet or electronic communication of a woman. So there's a punishment prescribed for stalking as well. I'm not coming on the part of punishment because I'm sure we have a legal audience and they'll be able to apprise themselves of the quantum of punishments that are there. Then Section 292, 293 generally provide for the punishment for sale, hire, distribution, circulation, exhibition of obscene content. Now, here there is also obscene content. 293 specifically provides that nobody should sell or give on hire or distribute or circulate obscene material to children, to youth below 20 years of age. So here, I mean, it's not just children. If a woman is, let's say, 19 years old and some kind of sexually explicit material is handed over to her, some pamphlet or something, even that would constitute an offense. We are yet to see cases where 292 or 293 has been invoked on an online sharing of any content as such. But these are also certain relevant sections. 383 is something that I thought of, for the offenses of sextortion. So where sextortion is not otherwise recognized in IT Act, there is no such section which provides for it. But if a woman's image is captured, in addition to certain other provisions of IT Act, where, if it is disseminated, 383 could be invoked. If the demand is of any money or valuable security. So 383 provides that if anyone puts a person in fear of injury to that person. So it includes an example, the threat of publication of defamatory libel. So we could take that further and say threat of publication of somebody's image, somebody's intimate image, and then asking the other person for money could constitute an offense of extortion under Indian Penal Code. Then 499 is the section on defamation, which says that a person, it is to defame a person with the intention of harming his reputation. And this can be done by way of visible representations of imputations concerning the woman or the girl child when it is done with the intention to harm her reputation. Now, Section 503, 506 that provide for criminal intimidation. Again, these are threats made to any person with injury to her reputation or to cause harm to her. 507 again provides for criminal intimidation, but that is criminal intimidation by an anonymous communication. And 509 is the most important, because when we are not able to find any other provision, a lot of cases go under 509, which punishes any person who utters any word, makes any sound or gesture, or exhibits any object with the intention that such word, sound, gesture or object shall be heard or seen by the woman. Now, this can be done online also. We got a complaint. I am a member of ICC committee of a law institute. And we got a complaint where, you know, during the online classes, certain boys had taken pictures of girls. And these were not per se nude pictures, but there were pictures where some of the, you know, for example, neck area, cleavage area of a woman were, they could be seen. And then these boys and some girls had a group on WhatsApp, and they started posting comments to each other, you know, making comments about this particular woman, posting her picture, making, you know, certain comments. And this girl was also part of that group. So, 509 was invoked there in that particular case. Now, relevant provisions under Information Technology Act, Section 43 is basically when somebody tries to delete, alter, destroy any data from a computer resource. 66C is basically when somebody is trying to make use of the electronic signature, password, or any other identity feature of other person. So when somebody wants to commit an identity theft or he commits an identity theft, usually we invoke Section 66C, and this is also for the offense of hacking. Now, 66D deals with cheating by personation. Now, 66E is commonly invoked with regard to violation of privacy of a person. This read with Section 354C, voyeurism. It is it reiterates that capturing, publishing, transmitting image of a private area of any person without her consent under circumstances violating her privacy is punishable with imprisonment, which makes 10 to 3 years. Commonly, the cases which involve images of women, they are punished under 66E. 67 deals with circulation, publication, transmission of obscene content. This is usually read with Section 292, 293 of Indian Penal Code. 67A is a very important provision, because it makes the publication or transmission of sexually explicit material punishable. And 67B makes publication, transmission of sexually explicit material depicting children as punishable offense. So 67A, 67B are extremely important. And like, you know, a residuary section 72 provides for breach for privacy and confidentiality. And women often invoke this as well, where their login details or their secure information is accessed by somebody.
Ma'am, sorry to interrupt you. But we are having less time, so I would
I'll try to wrap up. Just give me 2 minutes. So then Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Act, I will not go deeper into sections because we are running short of time, but Section 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, they basically provide for, you know, sexual harassment upon a child in the sense that any kind of pornographic material or, you know, the kind of sexual harassment if committed upon a child, POCSO covers that, and POCSO is a very, very stringent legislation. So at least so far as children are concerned, I feel that the legislative framework is still better. But when it comes to women, it is we still need to update law. One of the examples of a lacuna would be the Sexual Harassment at Workplace Act. The Sexual Harassment at Workplace Act does not specifically pinpoint or provide that you know, whether a sexual harassment committed online would be covered under the POSH Act or not. So there is no express provision. I have written a short article on it. Anybody who is interested could, you know, could visit Live Law. And if you type out my name, you will see that I've written an article of, you know, the virtual workplace. And there I've tried to answer that question. I'll not go on case laws given the paucity of time. I will just say that, you know, what you should do. I'll quickly come to that. So women should keep out, because we are saying tackling gender violence, apart from having a robust legal framework, you need to ensure your own safety. Keep an eye out for fraudulent messages, websites, secure your online presence. Be careful while giving out your mobile numbers, or you're giving out your mobile devices PC for servicing, because you may have confidential pictures in it. If you see that there is any content, any adult content or a content related to child pornography, or there is sexual explicit material, you should report it. And be mindful of your own appearance on video chat, video calls, especially during classes, because we don't know. I mean, I recently had this experience where, like I said, there's an educational institution, other students taking students' pictures and then posting on WhatsApp groups. It may cause some kind of harassment. So, I mean, we need to exercise care and caution. And do not use your smartphone too much for taking intimate photographs. Do not share your intimate photographs with strangers. That is most important. So I think that's pretty much it. Thank you very much for having me here today.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your words. Now I would like to request another eminent speaker, Professor Dr. Kiran Rai. A short brief intro about ma'am. Professor Dr. Kiran Rai is a recipient of University Gold Medal in LLB and LLF and postdoctorate. She has over 13 years of teaching experience in various reputed universities. She has been in Nirma University, Amity University in Noida, IBM Business School, Galgotia's University, and she is recently holding a post in Maharashtra National Law University. In 2016, she joined, and she is assistant professor and HOD, UG and PG department. Professor Rai is also the convener of Center for Training and Research in Corporate Regulation. Professor Rai has also publications to her, many publications to her credit, and she has also collaborated with many programs with NHRC, NCW and CCI. She has been visiting faculty for the course of legal aspect of business at Institute of Engineering, Nirma University, IBS Mumbai, and National Institute of Industrial Engineering. Her interests include research methodology, company law, law of contract, corporate governance, merger and acquisition, competition law, RTI, and private international law. So, ma'am, over to you.
Thank you, Neha. It feels so good when you see your student doing so well. So I would like to thank Shobhit University, specifically Associate Dean Dr. Imran, other faculty members, and my co-guests, Miss Meera, and I think one guest is yet to join. Let me tell you before I begin my lecture that Neha was one of my favorite students. I still remember when I was seeing her compare this program, I still remember the bubbly, very vibrant child, ready to change the world. So I hope that you keep that your attitude still strong, and you pass on your energy, your enthusiasm to the students.
Thank you. Mom.
Thank you, Shobhit University. And I assure you, you have got a good hand in form of Neha. You would be proud like I am proud of her. So coming to this cyber stalking and coming, taking reference of my age, having interacted with young students for quite a while of time, I was thinking we have two legal experts in this panel. One is already an advocate on record, and another is retired district judge. So what should be my focus area as a faculty? Now, whatever I do, I would not be better than whenever I'm talking about law and all and the usual challenges on ground. better than them. So what I thought of focusing my presentation on, what would be the narrowing down. So I have made my presentation with the point of research objective rather than briefing about the law. So instead of talking about cyber crime at length, because I knew one or the other dignitary would be taking us through the law, and Ms. Meera, she has given us elaborate picture by even explaining to us different types of cyber crimes and what is the challenges in the ground, what are the types of cases that are coming. So that work has been made easy for me. I would like to relate, take from where Ms. Meera has left, what is happening in COVID time. So taking that to the COVID-19 situation and cybercrime. So I'll just take a minute to share my screen so that we have the presentation is in a flow.
Ma'am, can
you? Yeah, so is my slide visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So though I would not be going into, so as a researcher, what we do, we know this COVID-19 era has come. Everybody is aware, even a layman would be aware, that the moment social distancing gained importance, the moment we were asked to sit at home, the interaction, social interaction was cut down. What happened? We shifted to our mobile, we shifted to our laptop. So the interface with cyber world or your technology world increased rather than with person. Now, when you have been devoid of human touch and you are mostly dependent on technology, this was the challenge when apart from using the technology in a beneficial purpose, like delivering an online lecture here from Mumbai, that is a good aspect of technology. But what had happened, there has been even bitter effects of use of technology during this COVID-19. And many researchers have jumped to find out how this social distancing and how this lockdown is changing our world when it is coming with various personal interaction or various crimes related to person. So when I was looking for research, I found out there has been substantial number of research abroad, but in India, I could find out one worthy research. Why I say worthy? Because in academia, we treat that to be worthy in the type of journal it has been published. So I could get hold of one research on increase of cyber crime during COVID-19 area. And this has been published in a journal by Taylor and Francis. So my first part of presentation would be to establish that yes, cyber crime has increased in this COVID-19 era because of increase or because of over dependency on technological or on the electronic gadgets. So my first half would focus on that. And second half would focus on few of the cases or the decimal picture when it comes not only to India, in the matter of relief, or not only in India, but globally also. So my presentation is focusing on two parts. And then I would like to end up with maybe sensitizing few students. My expectation is that if I could sensitize few students, that at the end, by indulging into cyber crime, you are gaining a small time pleasure. But what serious consequences it has on the victim's life, and it might have if suppose law takes its own course. So if we go by the, now to narrow down, whenever you are a researcher, and if you're talking about, so the topic is, I have chosen, though the topic was cyber crime and COVID-19 era, I narrowed it down to cyber stalking. Why did I narrow it down to cyber stalking? Because this is one wrong, which many youngsters, they do without realizing that actually this is a crime. So they may take it innocently. They may think that it is not going to cause serious harm. Okay. And sometimes they may not be aware that whatever they are doing, it comes under a crime as a cyber stalking. So I narrowed it down to cyber stalking and COVID-19 era. So our focus is on COVID-19 era, but few cases, when we are going to go globally, we will be talking about few cases in pre-COVID-19 era. So this cyber stalking, though the definition would be vary, for my research purpose, I have taken this from UNODC 2015. What is the definition of cyber stalking? If you read news article, NCW in the month of April to December, they had done various consultation on cyber crimes. And thankfully, when they did the consultation for Western Zone, I was a part of it. So we did somewhere in the month of June, and they had understood, they had taken up the challenge of this lockdown and increased cyber crime. So for the purpose, that time also for the purpose of identifying, or when you are taking a research and you have variable definitions, please narrow down to one definition that would suit to your research. So I have taken this definition of cyber stalking, which talks about very clearly more than one incidence. Now, if you recall your taught class, if you recall your class of defamation, whenever you are talking about defamation, you say one of the important ingredients is, even if you do defamation in IPC, if given the time, seeing the nature of exhaustive sections in IPC, the important factor is it should not be one of a kind of affair. It has to be more than one incident when it comes to defamation. And all this cyber stalking, cyber bullying, they are ultimately, as already Ms. Meera has said, that after repeal of Section 66A, Supreme Court, we should acknowledge that they are very forthcoming in repealing the laws, but they do not provide a solution. So with repeal of Section 66A, what they did not realize that they had taken away a relief for cyber stalking. So anyway, having done that, we have enough provisions under IPC to be protected. So what we have to understand is, whenever we are talking about cyber stalking, it is more than one incident. Another important aspect which we should be pointing out to the perpetrator is annoyance. So the word is annoyance. If you are repeatedly writing to me, following me, chasing me, which is leading to annoyance, you have to relate it even to defamation, which is must not to my liking. Okay, you can even relate to assault. You can even relate to wherein you are causing physical discomfort. So this all are harm to your body and to image. So even if it is causing annoyance, it may be leading, it would be treated as cyber stalking. So here, though the definition is very good, but problem is in implementation. So for the perpetrator, even if I can prove that it is causing discomfort to me, annoyance, it will be cyber stalking. And what are the modes through which you can annoy the victim? It could be by frequent emailing, by instant messaging, by calling, by texting. Now, sending unwanted messages on WhatsApp. I will share one or two even practical experiences where I don't know whether the student knows or not that he is indulging into the cyber stalking, even when continuously he is trying to contact a faculty. Okay, so what is important is, if you're constantly emailing and you're not getting reply, still you're putting messages, WhatsApp, texting, calling, okay, and what is the content? You're trying to communicate obscene, vulgar, defamatory comment, okay, threat to the victim or to victim's family, partner and friends by using technology. And even this threat, what is important for us to understand is, use technology. How will I say that you are threatening me or you are causing discomfort? Even if you regularly monitor me, if you in a survey or you follow the victim's movement, or you start posting on a group, okay, it may be offensive information. Also, you may be making a fake account. There are 4 or 5 cases wherein the victim's fake Facebook account had been made and obscene pictures had been posted. And this goes not much later than 2018 and in different part of India. So all this amounts to cyber stalking. So the important point is you're flooding the user's inbox with email. Now this is annoyance. This might come as a cyber stalking. You're frequently posting on the user's online sites, pages, and social media accounts. You may not be realizing, but actually you are doing cyber stalking. Okay, sending follower and friend request. So what is happening? You are sending a friend request which is not being accepted, and then you keep on texting, messaging, you're following, you're seeing the chat or every comment which the person is making on the social media, and you're liking, disliking, or giving your opinion, even if it is not unsolicited, okay? And on that media platform where you cannot be blocked, okay? You're joining all those online group and communities where the person is a member. So this all will amount as a circumstantial evidence that you are stalking the person, okay? So I think, please remember your tort class. If I cannot take you to IPC, I can always make a tort claim against you wherein I will have to only give preponderance of evidence. I need not have to go beyond the doubt, and I can give hefty damages. If not, I can penalize you with criminal liability. So now coming to having set this cyber stalking, what has happened in COVID-19 era? Social distancing and lockdown. Now you have been chained to your home. Now the joke goes on in couples that I think Neha Dhrupia, just on lighter note, she was there in some interview, and then she said that I have a daughter, and if my daughter, she grows up and she asks that what should I look for in a man? And then decide whether I should marry or not. So I would say go with a lockdown. If you can survive with a man for 6 month lockdown, you can sail throughout the life. Now that was on a lighter note, but you know, this has a serious consequences or effect in our discussion. I would like to take you, Ms. Meera had already referred to NCW's, the data which they had collated. I would like you to take to that slide and making a reference to this. I don't think you're able to see this. Let me go to the NCW website and let me see if I can show you. No, I am not able to. Okay, so let me tell you here, actually you would not be able to see this. You will get this data if you're writing a paper. Please put this data as an annexure. If you see cyber crime against women, it has increased after the lockdown, and then it even got reduced. Also, parallelly, if you see the domestic violence, it also increased. Now, what has happened for my research purpose? What I found out that in COVID-19 era, though the cyber crime also increased and domestic violence also increased, but if you check the news articles, you will find maximum researches or references being made to Domestic Violence Act or increase of domestic violence in this COVID-19 era. And somehow this cyber crime, it got shadowed or overshadowed by this extra attention given to domestic violence. And even that data shows to you. But what is the problem? Domestic violence, though it captures only the married couple, problem with cybercrime is it is in fact the victims are young boys and girls. Now I have an objection. When I had participated in NCW conference, I took for my presentation only laws, and then in that presentation, I made only what are the lacunas or what are the arbitrary terms which have been used in various IPC laws, which are not sufficient enough to nail it down to the different cyber crimes and how we should be making it specific. So one of my concern was that why we are talking about, even with the Shobhit University, I would request you that you should be increasing the horizon rather than only focusing to females as a gender. Now, when we talk about cybercrime, we understand mostly women or female genders, they are the victims of this wrong. But there are instances where boys have been victim of this. So if we increase the scope, that gives the even better scope for research, and it gives us the wide audience, and it increases the horizon. So this cyber crime is not only affecting the married couple, it is affecting the young generation, be it boy or be it a girl. But the problem with our law is that it is mostly gender specific, and that too it is women specific. So I will go to the law, specific law, but so you will get umpteen number of data which will tell you that how technology use has increased. Okay, how we have increased the screen time. There has been increase in social media platform. Now, if you look in your family also, like my mother-in-law who is 80 years old, because of this lockdown, we had made her well acquainted to WhatsApp group and Facebook. Now, this is a good side. But what I'm trying to say, there are many people, there has been many people who have now started increased use of social media platform. So there has been internet services has been increased from 40% to 100% of their previous in the pre-lockdown. What was there in pre-lockdown level to in the initial 3-4 months. Now, this is all data which I have taken from the internet. You will get the sources of this. Okay, now this paper of 2018 and 2019, they have suggested that social media usage and cyber engagement amplify detrimental effect on cyber bullying, cyber harassment, and cyber stalking. Okay, and keeping all this in mind, my government Twitter handle had shared some information on how you can protect yourself from being cyber stalked or from being cyber bullied. So Indian government understood when they went with the lockdown that we should give some precautionary or some guidance to this new users of technology. Okay, also there had been victims, this paper of 2019, the one paper I was talking where they have done research on how cyber stalking or cyber crime has increased in COVID-19 era. So they reported, they have given solution that report to the concerned government authorities, report or block them, remove them from social media platform. But actually solution given is very easy, but what is the practice? I will take you through that and how the what is the dismal picture of it. So I'm not going to go into the data. This research, N1 Light NGO organization, it has said that in COVID-19 era, there has been 70% increase in cyberbullying. And sometimes these teenage students, they do not understand that whatever they are doing actually accounts for cyberbullying. Okay, so these are the various research that had happened in COVID-19 era, where they have said often attempts by victim to distance themselves, to ignore the stalker, has resulted into serious consequences. So as a faculty, what I will advise the student, block it, okay, forget it, do not respond. But what this study shows that the victim, the moment it tries to ignore the perpetrator, they become more offensive and it's deteriorating the situation. So whatever as a family member solution we are giving, it is actually not working. Okay. Now, in this research, they have found out of 2020 that burden by all the institution, like if you go and register a complaint, what is the attitude of police officers? They always put burden on victim, and hence victims are very reluctant to go and file a complaint about cyberbullying or cyber stalking. Then obviously the fear of not being believed and the fear of the consequences of reporting. This was in pre-COVID era, and this is also prevalent in post-COVID era, that police authorities, they do not appreciate or they do not support to the victims whenever the reporting is being done. So the situation has not even changed. It was same or detrimental or pathetic situation pre-COVID era, even in post-COVID era. So these types of researches are already being done, because they have quite early, these researchers, quite early, they identified what would be the repercussion of using technology in this lockdown. Okay, so what had been criminal justice response? This paper has even dealt in, like in India, the perpetrator, this case, I would tell you, this perpetrator, though police filed a case, it was established that yes, he had done cyber stalking. But when police went to arrest the guy, he said, I am into COVID-19 lockdown. Okay, so I am a COVID-19 patient. You cannot come and arrest me. So this research shows how in England, even arrest could not be done because of COVID-19. Okay, and since the judicial officers, this another research says, what is the challenge in COVID-19 era is that the judicial, the courts are blocked. Okay, they are not working, or they are working with lesser strength. So if any case is registered also, there is no speedier redressal in COVID era. So these are the challenges of COVID era in registering a case or in taking up it to the judiciary. Now, very quickly, in 3 minutes, given my 3 minutes, I will just like to take you to the section 354D, for example. It says, it is already, because we go with that mindset, any man. So we have already believed the perpetrator would always be a man. Okay, though there are instances where women have cyber-stalked a woman, or man has cyber-stalked a man, why not even consider third gender, who are becoming now part of the regular, our day-to-day life, okay, follows a woman. So this is the limitation, just an example, which I am telling you, limitation of our law, which already presumes something, it becomes difficult to nail it down. Now, coming down to this case, in fact, here what they said, that every time a video by hacking somebody's mobile phone, an obscene video was uploaded in a porn site. And in this judgment, district court said every site, every time anybody opened that video, it amounted to virtual rape. So, but what happens? Though you have these situations only handful. Now, is India the only place where situation is grim? No. Even across the globe, situation is very, very grim. And it is not that people from our younger generation only indulge into this, or people from poor strata indulge into these types of crimes. I will close with the final account of a person, case of cyber harassment, where a CEO of a top pharma company constantly was cyber stalking. And as was told by Ms. Meera, he had the audacity that he went and he morphed the picture of the lady's husband with his face, and then he was using her photo and his photo on Twitter handle. And finally, when she reported, only what was the remedy given? That the Twitter handle was blocked. Okay, so this was the remedy given. And the last dismal picture is that in US, there is this Colin McAlone, who works for cyber stalking against men and women in US, Singapore, Germany. And then she was cyber stalked by a person in US. Her image was maligned. And after following this for 8 years, see, she was an activist. She followed this case for 8 years. She lost her job, lost huge revenue. And then the perpetrator, after 8 years, got a punishment of only 3 years. So, though this leaves the victim tarnished, it makes a huge dent on the psychology of victim, cybercrime, but the apathy with the practitioners or the judicial officers or implementation of law is very poor throughout the world. So I feel as a mother or as a teacher, my prime responsibility is to sensitize my students, and then later on we can take the help of law to sensitize students not only to not do, but if they are victim, how to take the course, even though the remedy would come quite late, but let us be the torchbearer and fight the case. With that, I close my presentation, and I hope that all the participants, they take this very seriously. And when you are writing a mail, if somebody is not responding, please do not keep on writing a mail. That will amount to cyber stalking. Okay? Because you're annoying somebody. With that, I end my presentation. Over to you, Neha.
Thank you, ma'am, for the words of the wisdom. There are some questions from the participant. I would like you and Meera ma'am to take that.
Sure.
One of the questions is, nowadays, if you complain a police regarding any cyber stalking or a prank call, they say that, madam, you can just block and they do not take any action. So are there many laws or still they are not implementing it?
May I answer this question? So basically, the police, they have a cyber cell. And there are mechanisms for them to, you know, to trace information, especially the IP address of the person who has done it. If you feel that your local police is not helping, you could complain online as well. So some of the, for example, in Delhi, you could file a cyber cell complaint online as well. So you could make a complaint, and there are mechanisms to trace it. So if they are saying simply block, blocking is one of the steps. Of course, one should block the person who is, you know, harassing you. But at the same time, they have to take steps to trace it. They cannot evade their responsibility.
I would like to add that after this suggestion, you can even go to NCW website. You can file your complaint, and they see to it that they forward it to the respective police. Okay, and then they are trying to even monitor. I don't know how much functional it is, but you can even file a complaint to NCW.
Yes, that is a very good suggestion, because they do follow up with the police as to what action they have taken on the complaint. So after you filed a complaint and you feel there is no action, a complaint can be sent to NCW as well.
There is one more question. That can you tell me, please, that what amendment can be done in the said law so as to deal with these cases against the children, that is cyber violence?
Basically, that would be a detailed legislative exercise. If you remember in the presentation, I had even given, some of the kinds of offenses, cyber offenses that are taking place against women. But, you know, the present legislative framework does not address most of those kind of offenses. In 66A, declared unconstitutional, what happened with me, there was a lady who contacted me. Somebody was posting defamatory content about her on Twitter time and again. This was not sexual content. But these were just offensive and, you know, offensive messages which were causing annoyance to her. And she wanted the cyber cell to take cognizance and take some steps. And they said, no, we cannot do anything. And she went time and again. And eventually, we even filed an injunction against the person who was doing it. We sought a restraining order from the court. So, I mean, a woman is made to, you know, travel so much. She has to approach the court for all these things. Then, you know, half of the women will be discouraged. So the kind of amendments we are looking at are user-friendly, you know, complainants-friendly, women, children-friendly complaint mechanisms, and fast actions on those complaints, which right now is not taking place in the current legal framework.
Okay, ma'am, there is one question from Subhankar
Pranwakar. Neha, just let me add. Yes, to the student, why don't you do, like ma'am had given you the compilation of various laws. So why don't you compile the laws and see how each and every word, it can be even modified, what is missing. That research you can do by yourself and then suggest for amendments.
Yes, ma'am, that's a good way. There's one question. Can we say that the increase in number of cases registered also signifies enhanced awareness, increased literacy rate, good governance, gender-sensitive policies, introduction of fast track court, etc.
Yes, reporting to some extent can also be attributable to more awareness and reporting mechanisms in place. But at the same time, it is, also because of the increase in the number of crimes. So, I mean, we cannot say one is the only cause. But yes, it can also be possible because of the increasing awareness, especially the sexual harassment at workplace offenses, for example. I do see more and more complaints coming in, even from the students now, where, you know, the students or other women were scared of reporting. Now, because there are gender sensitization programs that take place every year in educational institutions, they do come up to report. So I feel that is helping. But at the same time, the crime is also increasing because we have our reliance on technology in this particular case has increased manifold.
I would like to share with respect to sexual harassment at workplace. I was a member in Nirma when I was there teaching. We had a case wherein it was in engineering department between two English faculty. Okay, so there was some SMS that was sent and the lady first ignored. Again, offensive SMS was sent. I'm talking about this in 2009, okay? And then that lady very sternly told that you don't have sense, what type of messages are you sending? And the person again sent that message. So we had an inquiry. We were about to ask that person to throw out from Nirma University. And fortunately he got job and he left before we could come up with a decision that he has to leave. There were ample evidences that he was sending jokes which were not to her taste. And though she has clearly, she had evidence that she had clearly she had told, please do not forward these types of jokes. Still he did that. Okay, so that may cost you your job. Here again, I am a member of chairperson of sexual harassment cell from the time I have joined MNLU Mumbai. Every year I get case from my hostel. In 3 years, I have got 3 cases. Okay. And we give punishment to the student, right? It could be like one community service, something or the other. And we encourage students to come and report. So we have kept students as a member in sexual harassment committee as well. So this committee is quite active. We should be very, very careful that when we are working, whether we are a faculties, co-faculties or a student, let us, if we are getting a stern, even we should be understanding implied or we should be understanding body language. So this is becoming quite active. In fact, yes. Corporates, we give even training in corporates. There are instances, I'm talking about big corporates, where I have handled a case like Schneider Electrics, which is an international firm. Okay, if time permits, I will just tell you the case in very quick manner. So these two were going together. Okay, they were much like a live-in couple. But in one party, the lady had drunk too much. So they were staying in a hotel, right? In party, she drunk. This fellow took her to a room. They had a relation, physical relation, but she brought a charge of harassment next day. And you know that a person was thrown out and he was wondering what I had done that day, which I had not done previously. But law very clearly says previously you had indulged into the relation, but every time you're not a couple, even we are talking about marital rape to be become a law. So he was asked to leave the company. So please do not take these things for granted when we are talking about spreading awareness. We are spreading awareness so that you understand, though it says very cliche like no means no, but actually it is true. No means no. Even if it is implied, please try to read the body language. Otherwise, it will land you in trouble.
There is one question that the identity of the victim who is filing the case is protected by the law?
Yes, it is.
In sexual harassment cases, yes, it is protected by law. And even in court, the name of the victim is not given. Even name of the accused is not given. It is state versus XXXX. That's how it is written even in the cause list.
Ma'am, there is some question from Isha. some practical steps which a teenager can take if he or she is facing cyber issues, because parents generally discourage filing complaints?
See, I will say, please go to your faculty if you are a student. Okay, your faculty is the next guardian. And since you're, if you're in law school, go to a law, if you're not in law school, go to a law school faculty. They will advise you. First, they will advise you, like Meera ma'am said, first step is to block, and then they will call or threaten, okay, informally, even if you have a close group circle. When I was growing as a student, हमारे समय तो साइबर स्टॉकिंग नहीं होता था, बट स्टॉकिंग होता था, तो हमारे ग्रुप के लड़के कई बार चले जाते थे और धमकाने, चलो देख लेते हैं टाइप का. बट दैट ऑन अ लाइटर नोट, प्लीज गो टॉक टू एनीबडी. दिस इज इफ समबडी इज हैरेसिंग यू, व्हाट इवन इफ यू हैड गिवन अ कंसेंट, नाउ यू आर नॉट इन अ रिलेशनशिप, पॉन दिस व्हाट यू आर कॉलिंग, व्हाट इज द टर्म, वेरी ब्लैकमेलिंग is very much in scene. Papers are being written on that. If you were in relationship, that does not mean when you are out of relationship that pictures can be used to put on social media. There is a case, I don't know if Meera ma'am can help me, where a husband, he got divorced and then he put his wife's pictures on public forum. Now this is cyber stalking. This is, you are infringing a dignity of a woman. Okay, this would not be permissible.
And this is also revenge porn that we discussed. That revenge porn is also built on the same concept, where the intimate partner who has access to such material, he releases or publishes this information. Now, this ideally should be punished. It should have more gravity. When we are talking about 376 and rape offenses, the new amendment that had come in 2013, it said if you are a person who is in the power or authority, who is in a position of trust, then there should be more punishment. Likewise, an intimate partner releasing material, there should be graver penalty imposed on him. But unfortunately, so far, I mean, I feel that the legislative framework is not that robust as of now.
Underlying statement is, go to anybody, go to your friend, go to your faculty. Maybe they will approach your parents and they will make understand. See, what will be wrong now if we do not take action? What has happened? There is no point dwelling on that. Okay. And as a parent, we should understand that there is no point shaming our child, be it a student, be it our own children, but taking it forward that he or she is not being harassed.
Communicating is very important, and I'm sure every educational institution has academic counselors as well. And UGC has also framed regulations around sexual harassment committee. So you have details of sexual harassment committee within the educational institution also. So you can contact and, you know, file your formal complaint.
Ma'am, there is one question.
As well. And it is kept confidential. It is not published anywhere.
Okay. Ma'am, there is one question, that old people who have taken to social media sites in COVID-19 and other communication platforms, which they have not well acquainted with that social media or communication platform, and etiquettes have become real problem with their repeated unsolicited communication. Any relief?
See, they will only send unsolicited to Nati, Pote, jo bhi hai. You do not want your dadi to come and view. Achha, with whom you're chilling, that is a problem. See, they don't even know how to send a message, okay, or to send a Facebook request. I don't think that is a challenge. What personally, in my personal case, what happened? My father-in-law contacted COVID and I had to rush to Varanasi. And my mother-in-law, because my father-in-law does not take to technology, so we had made her a part of WhatsApp group so that we can communicate. My brother-in-law is in UK and I'm in Mumbai, so we could communicate. Now, she used to get all this faltu ka porn website ka SMS. Now, she was so irritated ki from where these are coming. And I was so shocked. So actually, for old people, whenever they use technology, they always come back and tell us that ki kya faltu ka technology mein tumne hume dal diya hai. So if you get unsolicited request, you can simply ignore. But I haven't seen that old people, they are sending request to people whom they don't know. They only send requests to their close relative just because they are lonely and they want to see what is happening in their extended family. That is it.
Yeah, ma'am. The last question, there's a, how should we look at the state surveillance in respect to the privacy of the woman in today's era with respect to the software application like Ligus? Till what extent is the state surveillance acceptable if it infringes the privacy of a woman?
Meera ma'am.
So basically, that law is yet to evolve. Obviously, there is a debate. It's a debatable area. The question is itself very debatable. Now, breach of privacy of a woman versus the surveillance. If the surveillance serves the purpose of ensuring her safety, because one of the reasons I feel there is an increase in cyber crime is also that the offender feels that nobody is watching me. You know, I'm doing it privately. There is no surveillance whatsoever. Now, if I look at it from this perspective, surveillance may be a good thing. I mean, that breach of privacy, the woman may say that, you know, I need my privacy. But at the same time, what comes with that surveillance is safety. There is a monitoring mechanism. There is somebody watching you. So then, because in India, people do not, they do not understand that they need to follow the law at times. If they're left alone, we have a lot of hooligans in our country. So if they're left alone, unsupervised, they're bound to be crime. So there, I feel surveillance is important. But obviously, both are equally important aspects. Privacy is one of our fundamental rights. So, I mean, we have to see how the courts in our country decide which will prevail over what. This is only with regard to women's safety point of view that I'm making this comment.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, we will come to the end of the program. Now, I would like to invite Ms. Mehak Batra, Assistant Professor, School of Law and Constitutional Study, for the vote of thanks.
Good evening, everyone. I, on behalf of entire fraternity of School of Law and Constitutional Studies, Sovjet University, Meerut, would like to especially thank our eminent guest speakers for gracing this event. I would like to thank Ms. Meera Kaur Patel ma'am for detailed explanation of all the legal provisions. It was a very informative information that you have gave us today. I'm sure all the attendees here must be very delighted by listening to you. I would also like to thank Professor Dr. Kiran Rai for providing such information and for sensitizing us regarding this topic. Your deep understanding of this issue and the way you explain each and everything was very delightful. I would also like to thank our Associate Dean, Dr. Imran, for providing us this wonderful opportunity to organize such an expert talk. And I would also like to thank Ms. Neha Bharti for the hard work that she has done and all the faculty members of School of Law and Constitutional Studies for making this event a success. And last but not the least, I would like to thank all the attendees here for gracing this event with their presence. Thank you so much, everyone, for making this event a success. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you very much, ma'am, for making sensitizing the students or making them about their rights and the precautionary measures to let them know. I'm equally thankful to Ida also for sparing the time. And would request that whenever the lockdown will be over and we will be open offline, we would request Kiran ma'am and Meera to come to the university, though Meera can come easily and Kiran ma'am is far away from Meerut. So whenever you are in Meerut, we would request to come to the university, to visit our university and to guide us that what new things we can develop and how we can go further.
Sure, sir. That would be my privilege. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Definitely. It'll be a pleasure. Thank you.